Our focus at Wicker is primarily designing secure messaging protocols. Can I see a count of how many people have used our product before, understand what it is? Cool. So basically, the idea behind Wicker is that we're building tools around strong encryption, privacy, and ephemerality. And by doing that, we notice that there's a lot of difficult challenges that people face in this industry. Mainly because secure messaging serves as a baseline for other infrastructure that you can build applications on top of it. As an example, the obvious one is that we can do text messaging in one-to-one, or maybe we could have group conversations. We can add file transfers. We can add voice and video. We can build bots to potentially work with DevOps and have some chat ops within the system. So because there's a high number of use cases and also a high number of users, there are some particular design challenges that we face. I mean, the main one is that the product has to be extremely usable. So a lot of times people that are using the product don't necessarily understand why they're using it. All they know is that they want the benefits of the security. The product, on the other side of things, has to actually be able to deliver on the privacy and security that a power user would expect, someone that's a security expert. And even within the secure messaging space itself, we find different threat models. So as an example, there's APIs. So the app has to talk to a backend server to be able to transfer the encrypted packets. There's end-to-end encryption, which is basically going to be our focus today. Long-term security of user data, because after the data gets transferred places, ultimately we need to be able to use it for something potentially over a long period of time. There's user anonymity, so whether or not we want to keep the actual identities of our users secret and at what level we're willing to add those protections. But the key thing to understanding the threat models themselves is that it's not necessarily just about passing end-to-end packets between two parties. As an example, we also have to worry about key and account management, endpoint management, user directories, data transports, and other items that might be required to complete the actual use case. So these things overall have a huge impact on the design of the system. And the more complicated the system gets, the more questions that users have. So is their user secured by validating crypto? Is it secure at rest? Is it secure when it's passing through the server? Can the server intercept the traffic? And in what sense, if any, are the users anonymous? So we're going to talk a lot more about threat models. And to get started, we'll talk about the classical threat model for secure messaging. So in this slide, you can see that Alice and Bob want to have a conversation. This is pretty much a textbook example of what you would normally think about when you're talking about messaging. So Eve is sitting in the middle, and her goal is to be able to either intercept the key or intercept the traffic. And more or less, the goal of Alice and Bob is to evade that from happening. So in this case, they're connected directly to each other over what seems to be an insecure channel. And this is historically one of the most studied problems in cryptography for a very long time. It's a well-understood model, and has a small number of variables. Obviously, the solution to Alice and Bob's problem is some level of end-to-end encryption. So they want to use a method of public key cryptography before sending over the channel. An example of this would be PGP or SMIME. And they're going to do that most likely by generating some sort of random symmetrical key. Then they're going to encrypt their data with that key, and then use public key cryptography to secure the symmetrical key so that they can send to each other over this insecure channel without Eve being able to get something in the middle. They can also potentially use the public key crypto to authenticate their message with digital signatures. This is something that we see in pretty much every system in the past. So there are a lot of buzzwords that are thrown around when it comes to secure messaging, and end-to-end encryption is probably the biggest one of those buzzwords. Sometimes it's used completely incorrectly, so you'll see products that consider that encrypting things between each leg of the transport separately is is end-to-end because theoretically the data was encrypted at each step. But in reality, our goal is to be able to encrypt something on one client to get it to another client without any servers being able to decrypt that data in between. So this begs the question overall, is end-to-end encryption by itself a sufficient defense mechanism in practice? So there are a lot of valid reasons why you would want to use end-to-end encryption, because it solves a lot of problems for people. And although end-to-end encryption has gained a lot of traction in recent years, particularly in consumer products, there are still a lot of providers who actually don't implement it. And they have a few reasons for that. So use cases. Potentially, they have server-side processing for some very smart AI features that they wouldn't be able to load onto a client because it's just simply not possible from a technical standpoint. They might also have some interesting usability requirements. As an example, they want someone to be able to jump on a web page and start chatting with someone without registering for the service. They could have legal requirements, compliance issues, regulations, things of that nature. Potentially their business model is completely against encryption, where the consumer is the product and this is the only way that they can have a viable product is having data that people provided them. There's also a whole set of people who just haven't understood its value. So let's talk about what those values are. For one, we can reduce assumptions around the security infrastructure. And what I mean by that is that typically we build these services out of a ton of microservices, and those services are interconnected in ways that maybe no one in the organization actually understands from a top level. Now, if we're sending end-to-end encrypted packets through that infrastructure, it becomes a lot less of a risk to the company for one of those pieces of infrastructure to compromise, because it doesn't necessarily lead to user data being leaked. And we can also push security closer to a mathematical proof rather than a pure assumption at the current time. So if we can prove something in a mathematical way, that makes a lot more sense for security as opposed to handling everything with, say, policy. Unfortunately, there's a tendency to have a good enough attitude towards message security, especially when it comes to consumer data. We've seen that in practice with breaches that have occurred. Most of the time, they're very large, and tons of things get disclosed. And there's a lot of, again, incorrect assumptions about the security of the components. In almost every case where a system gets breached, they didn't expect for that to happen or know that that vulnerability existed. If they did, they probably would have done something against it. So they might have an assumption against, say, the network-facing qualities of databases or components that talk to those databases and which components have access to those databases. They might also have an assumption against authentication schemes, how strong they are, can they be brute forced, etc. Or just simply access control, which employees have access to these databases. Maybe someone gets fired and decides they're going to turn everything over to someone who wants to pay them money. And of course, 0 days are all too common. Keeping up with them is not reliable, so we have to think about hope not being a strategy in this case. Obviously, plain text messages that are stored on any system have the capability to be compromised. And other threats come into play when an attacker gains access to infrastructure, which Joel will discuss a little bit later. But from a high-level view, we're certainly better off passing end-to-end encrypted packets than not end-to-end encrypted packets. User privacy is also a huge value to customers. When customers know that they're being handled in a way that their privacy is valued, they tend to have a lot more trust in the system and use it a lot more, especially for high-stakes conversations. And people like myself, who help engineer the system, can just sleep a little bit better at night, knowing that one day they're not going to wake up in the morning and find out that 5 gigabytes of unprotected user transactions have just hit the internet somewhere. So back to the slide with Alice, Bob, and Eve. There are several interesting things that you might notice about this scenario. If you can think about the different messaging systems that you use, how many of them would you actually think that you could describe in this diagram? It's very, very difficult. And And the reason for that is because this is a highly simplified view and most likely will not exist in reality. As an example, this doesn't describe any method of authenticated key distribution between these two people. So how do these keys get to the two endpoints in the first place? That's an open question. The other thing is, we don't know how they manage their keys. So, you know, when they're sitting there and they're just waiting to send information, where are those keys? And how are those keys protected? The other thing is, we don't have a definition here of what we think Eve can actually learn from the network traffic. And also, what kind of traffic that is. So it might not just be messaging traffic. Maybe they're logging into the server, and in a poor design, the server is actually just sending them their key to the network or something. And now there's a design challenge that we have to fix. In practice, the lack of details in the scenario opens some other questions about the design of the server as well. As an example, there has to be some method of registration, and user identity is going to be defined by signing keys, and those signing keys will have to be distributed to people in a way that we can reduce man-in-the-middle attacks. There's also an important topic of peer discovery. So as an example, being a messaging company like Wickr, our goal is so that people can find each other to talk to each other. And all secure messaging systems kind of work in this way, but there's a balance between the anonymity part and the ease of use part. So as an example, contact book access is something that's debated quite a bit in this field. So if someone's supposed to be anonymous, uploading their contacts might not make sense, but at the same time, uploading their contacts means that now they're able to find people more easily, and they might communicate in a secure manner as opposed to an insecure one. There's also the facilitation of message delivery through REST or socket-based endpoints. So we have to consider what kind of havoc you can cause by sitting in the middle of those protocols, which actually lie completely outside of the end-to-end encrypted messaging protocol. So we've already discussed Alice, Bob, and Eve characters, but what about Mallory? So Mallory is someone who wants to attack the system in different ways. We're dealing with eavesdropping by using end-to-end encryption, but there are several important things that give Mallory opportunities to take advantage of the system in other ways. So one of those things is asynchronous messaging. So when we use channels on our phone, we're talking to a server. We're not talking directly to the other people. And part of that is that there has to be some infrastructure in the middle that's determining how to forward those packets to other people in a way where both people could potentially be offline. And we have to take that into consideration because that automatically puts a man in the middle. So we have to be able to defend against that. There's also key distribution while parties are offline. So we'll have to do things like have an identity key and sign ephemeral keys and store them on servers, because that's the only way that we'll be able to preemptively give people keys of parties that might not be there on the other side. And one of the other things that's important is that we try to focus on encryption first and then validating that encryption after the fact. And the reason for that is because we would prefer that users establish a secure channel as quick as possible and validate that as they need, as opposed to having to validate the security before they start transmitting, which would be a huge hurdle. So they wouldn't really be able to communicate if that were the case. There's also offline clients reading messages, which means that you have a server-side queue. And that creates an interesting thing because the server can potentially drop packets or mess with the transcript. So those are things we have to take into consideration. There are also multi-party chats. So multi-party chats raises a lot of questions because the one-to-one scenario that we viewed before only has two people. And that line in the middle of them, if that became a matrix or a web, like that just makes things exponentially more difficult. And end-to-end encryption classically doesn't scale well in that scenario. We also have things like file sharing and VoIP. So in file sharing and VoIP, these are scenarios where we have another channel that has to be secured, the same mechanism as the messaging channel, except they're completely unrelated. So when we talk about threat models, a lot of them have to do with if someone compromises the VoIP system, they theoretically compromise the messaging system as well, because they're using the same key exchange mechanisms. The other thing is, users need to get up and running very quickly. And they need to find other users quickly, as I mentioned before. So trying to get rid of hurdles for the user also could potentially reduce security. Those are things that we have to consider when building these products. So the threat model becomes the most important tool we have in working on solutions to these challenges. We have to define the objectives of the security architecture first, then identify the ways that it can be attacked, define reasonable solutions for mitigating those attacks that work for our system. And that's a very important point. It's not so much right versus wrong as it is what's right for your product. And how do you determine what's right for your product? Well, you need to first start with what your goals are, and then clearly communicate those properties to users. Once you communicate those properties to users, you have to be able to get them verified. And typically, a third-party audit is the way to do that. So something that we would do as an example is create something we call customer promises. So we draft a document that basically says the things that we're willing to guarantee that we will do for you, and nothing more. And if those things cannot be verified by a third party in an easy way, they have to be taken off the list because they're just not something that we can promise people. So, as far as threats are concerned, our goal as a group of security professionals, is to analyze the threats that we discovered in the wild, and then adapt mitigations for those threats to the threat model. Different threat models can have different usability impacts. As an example, message history might not be available on a new device I sign in on because I didn't have keys before that started. And on the other side of things, allowing messages to be sent before validating keys increases productivity of users and has an easy trade-off. So we like to find optimal solutions. For the rest of the talk, we're going to be describing the actual attacks on systems that we've seen in the wild, lessons we can learn from those attacks, and how those lessons can be used to strengthen our threat models. So these threats fall into several categories. There are attacks on long-term privacy, attacks on using the reliance on phone networks, particularly around login, attacks on authentication, traffic analysis, group messaging, weak design choices, and legal attacks. So let's talk about long-term security a little bit. So message applications build up a huge amount of data in a short amount of time. Also, users like to hold their identity for a long period of time. And these two things in combination can lead to problems. As an example, with PGP, you might have one key that you're using for 5 years and communicating with 20 different people. So, of course, the problem with that scenario is that basically if someone gains access to that key, then we're pretty much screwed. All of our transcripts are going to be released on the internet, and the thing about it is that there's nothing we can do about that. So all future data that's sent with that key, maybe I didn't even know it was stolen as an example. So I'm still using it, and people are getting that traffic. And I also have no recourse to prevent them getting data from the past and releasing that. So because malware only needs to get access to the key one time, what do we have to do about that? Well, we want to do what's called implementing forward and backward secrecy. So the idea of forward and backward secrecy is that we want to limit the amount of time of data that is able to be captured to when a particular secret key was in use. And as far as implementation goes, basically what we're trying to do is rotate in new and fresh key material as fast as we can and as often as we can. And those keys can't be related mathematically to any of the prior or future keys. And what that does, in essence, is that it gives us small windows of compromise. So if a user gets compromised at any given time, maybe the attacker only gets two messages. And because they got that one key and I was able to recover by posting up a new key to my contacts, now I'm protected against my future conversations being released. And then what about client compromise though? So we have this system where ultimately I want to read my messages. So we just discussed that we need forward and backward secrecy to delete keys as fast as possible so that only small windows of information can get captured. However, once the message leaves that part of the system and is sitting on my device, all the rules of that part are gone because I need to be able to read messages. Essentially, a messaging app that only displays one or two messages at a time would not be very useful for people. So what exactly happens to a message after it leaves the end-to-end encrypted transport and is on my client? Well, I first delete the encryption keys to ensure forward secrecy. And because of that, the messages cannot stay in their in-transit form. Messages have to be stored in the database, ultimately. So client-side storage and long-term availability open us up to new attacks that weren't there before. This message transformation creates a problem for long-term security of the chat transcripts. There's a few reasons why we have to deal with things on the client side as well as on the network. So users are historically very bad at deleting messages that they no longer need. You can think about this in terms of your own phone. So I'm sure basically all of us have some sort of SMS or chat conversation that's been running for 3 years, and we definitely would never want to search that information, but nonetheless, we have all of it sitting on our device. And users are also historically bad at endpoint security. So you can imagine even a less technical person that tends to get malware on their computer or, you know, just doesn't understand that they should have a strong password. And we see this all the time. So if malware breaks into a system housing a client, we would assume automatically that the jackpot is hit due to these two basic principles. So what can we do to protect that client data? Well, for one, we can create an encryption key that encrypts the data on the client. But that sort of creates a chicken and egg scenario, because that key is also sitting on the client. So what do I do with it? Well, there's tools that people can use. As an example, the secure enclave in iOS, and even that could work with biometrics or just the keychain by itself. Several tools can use that to make sure that at least if someone gets disk access, they don't get access to all the messages. What we can also do is let the user lock the device with a passphrase. And we can use something like Scrypt that has really, really good brute force detection in order to accomplish this for us. But what about the lifetime of messages? So can we do anything about that? Any of you that have used the Wicker product would have seen that basically we self-destruct messages by default, and there's no way to turn it off. So every message has to have a lifetime. And this is basically the implementation of an automatic deletion policy for content. It can be dictated by a sender, receiver, server admin, or really anybody. But the goal is that data that doesn't exist on the client can't be compromised. So the client is compromised. And sometimes having a slight inconvenience of not being able to search messages from years ago could really save you in a lot of situations. Of course, there's also anti-forensics work a little bit that has to go into that. And there could seriously be an entire talk just on that in itself. So our goal is basically to control the life cycle of data on the client. And that data could be the messaging data, as we've just discussed. It could also be temporary files. So we need to be very vigilant as people implementing these sort of systems to understand how the operating system and libraries that we might use from third parties manage temp files. A perfect example of this would be like, let's just say I have an image library that I'm displaying images in the UI in the messaging. And maybe that image library writes the image to disk as a temp file. And I don't know that, and it's keeping a giant cache of all those images. So now all the work that I've done previously is kind of thrown out the window. So doing audits on these things is really important, and making sure that we understand the threat model of the life cycle itself, all the content that we find and create, is important. Another place where this comes into consideration are things like backup. Do we really want our encrypted database with all our messages to be backed up to a cloud server controlled by Apple or Google or some other provider? Probably not. So a lot of times the best thing to do is just to realize that if users are going to need to get a new device, that they're essentially, all their messages are destructing at that moment. And that's pretty much just the reality that they'll have to do. So one of the other things that's important when talking about long-term security is the long-term security of the crypto itself. So even in a perfect end-to-end encrypted system, changes to the reliability of the cryptography that goes underneath it is a threat to us. So a compromise to, say, the mechanism that we use to exchange secrets would pretty much automatically lead to all of your users being fully compromised and all of their content that exists somewhere to be captured. And the thing is, when we talk about the threat model, we have to assume that people are recording all of this traffic all the time. Because if we don't, we might have issues. So governments, as an example, place relatively high value on retroactive decryption of traffic. They might be storing huge amounts of even HTTPS traffic or whatever they can really get their hands on, because storage is cheap, and they understand that quantum computers are ultimately being built. So let's talk a little bit about quantum computers. So currently, almost all systems are implementing forward secrecy based on some variant of the Diffie-Hellman key exchange. So quantum computers are very efficient at two particular things. They can factor the product of large integers, and they can solve discrete log over arbitrary proofs. So what exactly does that mean for modern encryption schemes? Well, RSA, as an example, works on the hardness of factor. So it can automatically be defeated by a quantum computer that's large enough. And with Diffie-Hellman, we're using discrete log. So both of those things are pretty much out right away. And all other public key crypto that's currently used in practice has these same issues. The good news, however, is that quantum computers are still really early in development, and it will be some time until hardware exists that can actually break these algorithms due to the amount of processing power we require. The bad news is that data being encrypted and transmitted today is vulnerable to a quantum computer in the future. Because remember, we said that people are recording all of this traffic so that they can go back to it at some point in the future and eventually break the crypto. So our goal right now is to try to think of long-term privacy from the standpoint that we must design our systems today and be forward-thinking of the attacker in the future. So what can we do about it? There are several algorithms that are being developed specifically to safeguard against optimizations that quantum computers can provide. An example of this is the Open Quantum Safe project, which is trying to get quantum safe algorithms into OpenSSL. And with that, I'll hand things off to Joel to talk about encryption.
Thank you, Tom. So, okay, time permitting, let's see how far I get. I'm going to tell you about several other types of attacks that we've witnessed in practice. I'll have to go a little faster than expected, and tell you a bit about what lessons we can learn from that. So, probably the most common way that security gets compromised in all kinds of systems, in particular also secure messaging and messaging platforms, is that the authentication database, so the user database, that is the usernames and hashes and passwords, gets compromised in some form or another. And we see this again and again all the time. So, okay, you know, there's all kinds of techniques that we can use here that we should be using. You know, be very careful about the host that hosts this database and things like that. We should do segmentation, you know. But really what I want to say here is that what we should be doing is looking at adversarial models where we give the database to the adversary. So we have to be, and this is kind of a general sort of theme throughout this talk, we need to look at adversarial models where we are explicit about the fact that compromises happen, and specific types of compromises. So for example, this database could get leaked, and we should plan for that eventuality by looking at that type of adversarial model. And when we look at that model, we start seeing that there are things that we can do to try and mitigate these type of situations. So for example, there are techniques like we should be using not just salt, but also pepper when we do the password hashing. So this is a global secret which is not stored inside the database, and it's held somewhere else on the server. So if you dump the database, you still don't know anything about that secret, but there's no way to do password hashing, to do offline dictionary attacks. Another thing is honey hashing. We should also definitely be using brute force resistant hashing algorithms. So for example, Scrypt, Argon 2 are good examples of this. In particular, I would recommend also using ones, password hashing algorithms that have inbuilt resistance to side channel attacks. So for example, not Scrypt, but Argon 2 has a mode, Argon 2i, which is strengthened against side channel attacks. And there, the thing is that you don't want to have, when you're hashing passwords, that you can use side channel attacks to learn things about the input, because the input is the password, and that's something you're trying to protect. So another thing that we've seen in practice that raises a lot of issues is the reliance on phone numbers as a means for authenticating or even identifying user accounts in secure messaging. So this is, again, this reflects this trade-off between usability versus security. And there are a lot of good usability reasons to want to tie accounts to phone numbers, which is why it keeps happening a lot in practice. However, this also leads to problems. So for example, August 2017, we saw the Iranian hacker collective Rocketkit compromised a slew of accounts for the Telegram secure messaging system. Now the way they did that is by intercepting the authentication SMS. So what does this show? Well, phone, depending on your threat model, depending on the threat actors you're trying to defend against, phone networks are very bad authenticated channels, right? And part of this comes from the fact that phone networks, the backbone of the phone network was designed in an age, you know, with the same kind of threat model as TCP/IP. That is to say, none at all. It's all sort of based on trust. But in the modern world, what that means is there's all kinds of holes, there's all kinds of ways to intercept SMS. And so, if you're trying to defend against nation-state actors, you're trying to defend against advanced threat actors, this makes for very bad security mechanisms. The other problem with phones using phone numbers and associating them in a strong sense with an account is that phones are most often the opposite of anonymous. So again, this was reflected in practical attacks. August 2016, so a year previous to the attack, the same group found a way to use the API of Telegram again to enumerate all phone numbers associated with the Telegram account in Iran. So this was effectively a de-anonymization attack, because in Iran, like in most countries, it's not possible to even have a phone number without first strongly tying your real-world identity to this phone number. So what that means is we should be looking at threat, in our threat models, when we're trying to model our goals and what threats we're facing, if we're at all interested in anonymity, then one of the things we should be doing is treating a phone number as effectively a real-world identity. Because in practice, that's usually what it is. So what that means is we need to be very careful when dealing with phone numbers. It's not to say that there aren't good reasons to do it, but we need to be very aware of the risks that are associated with that. Another area that is growing in terms of attacks, and people are coming around to the idea that there's a lot of work that needs to be done here, is traffic analysis. Traffic analysis on encrypted data. So normally, traditionally, when we think about encryption, you know, you think you encrypt some data, boom, that's it, it's private. As long as the keys aren't revealed, you've got a sound encryption algorithm, everything's good. But in practice, there's all kinds kinds of side information that's getting leaked. The length of a packet, the timing in which these packets are being sent. And what ends up happening is, in practice, we're trying to optimize for things like bandwidth. And so what we do is we use length-preserving encryption. So what that means is, if I show you a ciphertext for most encryption techniques that we use, you know exactly how long the message is. And if you're sitting on the wire, you also see the exact time when I'm sending these messages. Now, this seemingly maybe not so consequential information actually has huge impact in practice when we talk about things like encrypted VoIP and even encrypted text messaging. So, for example, there have been demonstrations of practical attacks on encrypted VoIP that have shown how to just looking at the packet length and the timing, how to determine what language is being talked in an encrypted VoIP conversation, and even pushing that further, being able to recover the content of what was said. And the reasons for that is because VoIP traffic tends to use a variable bit rate in codings. And so that leaks an awful lot of information about the individual phonemes of the language that are being used. And in fact, people have used, you know, pretty powerful statistical models, machine learning techniques, to really be quite successful in extracting the information, pertinent information that's encrypted. The same goes for encrypted texts. It's surprisingly, a lot of information is leaked just by the lengths when we're not doing anything else. So what's the lesson to be learned here? Well, basically, our threat models need to take this into account explicitly, that when an attacker sits on the wire, they're learning things like timing, message lengths, and that leads to looking at defense mechanisms like, we need to be more careful with padding, or we need to try and obfuscate things about how long the actual message is. And right, and for VoIP traffic, definitely a lesson here is that when possible, when we're able to take the hit in computation and bandwidth, we should be looking at constant bit rate. Because in a way, that's a way, again, of obfuscating like features of the sound that's actually being encoded. So we need to assume that the adversary, we need to be explicit about the fact that the adversary is learning these extra parts of information. Another area where we do have some problems as well is multi-party conversations. So something that's a tendency that happens in practice is that people, we design two-party secure messaging, two-party VoIP, and then afterwards we're like, okay, now let's extend into the multi-party case. But in reality, there's a whole new array of problems that we're faced. And some of these things are simply that the techniques we use for the two-party case don't scale well. For example, if you want to do forward secrecy, we usually do a key agreement to agree on an ephemeral key. Well, in a multi-party case, we don't know how to do a multi-party key agreement. We don't have practical schemes for that, so you actually need completely new techniques. But worse, more than that, there's new security considerations. There's new attack surfaces that arise in a multi-party case. So what do we need to do here is we need to model these things more explicitly. And we need to treat these more explicitly as their own problems rather than as an add-on to the two-party case. So things like we have race conditions. What if you have a room with two administrators that simultaneously try and remove each other from the room? You don't want to end up in a situation where you're in this room. These are the kind of things that don't arise in two-party case. Or transcript consistency. People expect these secure messaging platforms to follow the analogy of a private room. Now, in a private room, when you say something, everybody else hears it at the same time. The conversation follows the same order. This is the expectation people have in their minds. But in practice, over the internet, this is not what's actually happening. And indeed, this is an active topic of research. A lot of it's happened just this year. But we've been finding that in a lot of the existing protocols, many of these security properties are not actually satisfying. And part of that is because I think a lot of the developers happen in a bit of an ad hoc way, patching things on top of the two-party case. And that needs to change. We need to be much more explicit about our security goals and our security models in the multi-party case. It's a much more complicated beast in reality. Alright, this is maybe a kind of more widely known, I would say, design choices, when we tend to try maybe overemphasize usability and forget about security. Again, this happens in practice and it gets exploited in practice. The enumeration attack in Iran exploited a weakness in the API, Telegram. There was a big uproar this year when it was silent, when it was discovered that WhatsApp allows for silent rekeying. Again, there's usability reasons for doing that, but the compromise in security there is so big that a lot of people are not happy about this. So at the very least, we need to communicate these decisions, and I would say we need to be a bit more careful about these kind of decisions, because this stuff is still happening in practice. Similar situation with iMessage. Apple distributes all keys through their key server, but doesn't provide the users of iMessage a way to then afterwards authenticate, to check that the key that they actually have matches the one on their contactless device. In other words, the security model there is effectively, we need to trust Apple and the connection to Apple, because there's no other way for us to check. The final category, unfortunately don't have too much time to tell you much about it, but these are sort of non-technical attacks. These are legal considerations which are becoming more and more of an issue for secure messaging. So, for example, government-mandated backdoors is becoming more and more on the topic. There is no technical solution to this, because this is about the laws that govern our organizations. And so, when we think about these threats, really, defenses that I would think are a good idea in this case is to formulate a policy ahead of time, so that your organization knows how it's going to react, and above all, communicate to your users what you intend to do when faced with these type of situations. Pull out of the country, comply. Whatever it is, we need to be explicit about this. And this is important because otherwise, especially in the face of this type of scenario, government bans on encrypted messaging, one of the reactions here, there are technical things that secure messaging can do, mainly trying to hide the traffic. So a good example from practice was that the Egyptian government blocked signal messaging around the time of the coup, the second revolution. And the reaction from Signal was to implement obfuscation techniques. Now, I cannot emphasize how important it is for Signal to communicate to their user base when they do these things. Because what ends up happening from the user's perspective is that it just works. But what they don't realize is that they are now using a tool specifically designed to circumvent local laws in a country that has no compunctions about arresting people for just that. So communicating to your users when you implement what your strategy is in the face of these type of legal scenarios is really important. Final one, again, another scenario where legal issues arrive. It's a bit tongue-in-cheek, maybe call this a threat, but it's definitely something that needs to be considered, is how to handle mandated metadata collection. So here the issue is, how do you want to comply? You need a legal policy, again, you must communicate this, it's really important. But also on a technical side, maybe you want to try and design your system to minimize your exposure to this kind of stuff by, for example, emphasizing P2P communication. Communication that doesn't go through your infrastructure, you can't report that metadata. So you kind of take the problem out of the picture. Weaker things would be things like, well, we don't record the metadata. I would consider that a pretty weak defense, because if it's the law that you do have to record it, well, that could be a law. So that's not clear to me that that's particularly